We're in the salt balance. This slide shows us what happens when you take salt. When you eat salty food, you take salt. What happens is you do not change the total volume of your body fluid, but you increase osmolarity. Then let's see what happens. First, behaviorally, it will trigger the thirst sensation. You feel thirsty. Because in integrative physiology, your behavior plays a role. So when you feel thirsty, you're going to drink water. And after you drink water, you fix the problem. You increase the ECF volume, and eventually your osmolarity go back to normal. And increase the volume also increase the blood pressure, so it will affect your CVCC. And the volume will affect your kidney as well, so you fix the problem. And also, when your osmolarity increases, there's a big trigger of vasopressin. So vasopressin will be released, you'll go to your kidney, and kidney conserve water, so you pee less. So that's what happens when you eat salt. And the hormone to regulate salt reabsorption is aldosterone. We live in the 21st century, we never feel like we need to keep salt. Actually, we have too much salt in our food. But it only happened in the past three generations. And in animals' body, in humans' bodies, through evolution, we are always looking for salt. And the salt is very important. We start to talk about the sodium from unit 1 when we talk about the action potential. So sodium is pretty important, and in the natural environment, we don't have much salt. And that's why in our body, we have a hormone dedicated for salt reabsorption, that's aldosterone. And the situation completely changed in the past three generations when the human's food have too much salt, and apparently it created a lot of problems. So let's look at aldosterone's function. That's the hormone aldosterone. Steroid. So it's a steroid hormone. It's a hormone released from your adrenal cortex. And it will target in your kidney T cells. Its function is absorb sodium. And when they absorb sodium, it will secrete potassium. So let's look at the molecular level, why it will lead to secrete potassium. So this is the molecular level, what happens. Aldosterone, it will diffuse through the cell membrane because it's steroid hormone, so simple diffusion. It will bind with the intracellular receptor and it will trigger the transcription, translation, new protein synthesis. Let's see what's the protein synthesis. The membrane protein produced is our old friend, sodium potassium pump. And the sodium potassium pump, you're very familiar with it. It will move the sodium and potassium in the opposite direction. That's why you take sodium back. You end up with secrete potassium. And aldosterone belongs to a big pathway called RAS system. The old textbook called RAAS. It starts from renin. Renin is a hormone produced by your kidney. The trigger is low blood pressure. So the pathway, this is a big pathway to bring your blood pressure back. That's its main function. In unit 2, when we talk about the cardiovascular system, you have the baroreceptor reflex. That's the main neuronal mechanism happen in your body to maintain your blood pressure. And the neuron is quick on, quick off. Now we see the endocrine system. Endocrine is also the long distance communication system in your body, and the endocrine system is slower compared with the nervous system. And the RAS, this system is a big pathway. Its function is to maintain your blood pressure as well. So your body, you have the neuronal mechanism to maintain your blood pressure. And this, you see this in unit 3, that's your hormone mechanism to maintain your blood pressure. When your blood pressure drops, it will trigger the RAS. And the kidney release renin. Renin is not a very important hormone. Its function is to turn adrenotensinogen, that's the hormone released by your kidney, turned into AMG1. And AMG1 is not a very important hormone, but when you have AMG1 in your plasma, in your blood vessel endotheliums, they have an enzyme ACE, going to turn ANG1 into ANG2. ANG2 is a very, very important hormone, very powerful hormone. So let's see its pathway. It's called RAS. ANG2 will trigger aldosterone release. And aldosterone's function is sodium reabsorption. When you take sodium back, water follows, so it fixes the problem of osmolarity. Let's see what else ANG2 can do. ANG2 is a vasocompressor. It will work in the blood vessels, arterial, small blood vessel. It will cause vasoconstriction. So when you constrict the blood vessel, the blood pressure increases. So ANG2 will fix your blood pressure. And ANG2 will also go to talk to the CBCC in your medulla oblongata. And it will increase the sympathetic output. It will also bring your blood pressure back. We learned this in Unit 2. And ANG2 will also go to talk to your hypothalamus. It will trigger the thirst sensation. So when you feel thirsty, you will drink water, fix the problem. And also, it will release vasopressin. Vasopressin will conserve water. And it's a big pathway to maintain your blood pressure. So now let's look at the other hormone do totally the opposite function. And that's AMP. This is hormone make you pee. That's how I memorize its function. This hormone is released from your heart. Your heart is also an endocrine organ. And you use cyclic GMP as the second messenger. So what's the trigger? Blood volume increase. So the previous slides tell you your body can fix when your blood pressure drop. Your body also need to do something when your blood pressure increase a lot. That's when you drink 2 liters of water into your body. And your heart gonna release this hormone, AMP. It's gonna quickly do everything within its power to decrease your blood volume, because too much blood volume gonna make your blood pressure too high and it's gonna harm your body. So its function, excretion of sodium and water. Also suppress all these pathways we just talked about. This pathway, their job is to increase your blood pressure. So you will do these two things. So let's look at AMP. Trigger, increase blood volume. So when you drink too much water, that's what happens. And the blood will go back to your heart. It's going to stretch your myocardial cells a lot. And when it's been stretched a lot, you're going to release AMP. So let's look at AMP's function. AMP, its main function is go to the kidney. It will ask the kidney produce more pee. So what? How they do it? Well, it will decrease sodium reabsorption. So more sodium go to the urine and go to the lumen, and more sodium there, well, more water will go there. It will also dilate the afferent arteria. When you dilate the afferent arteria, it will increase the GFR. So also more blood can be filtered into kidney. So all of them will decrease your blood volume. And let's see what else. It will go to the hypothalamus, suppress the vasopressin release, because this totally do the opposite function. It will go to the adrenal cortex, trigger less aldosterone release, because aldosterone will trigger the sodium reabsorption. It will also do the opposite function. It will also go to your medulla oblongata, your CVCC, decrease sympathetic output, because 1, 2, 3, these three will do the opposite function. These three will increase your blood pressure, so we'll inhibit these three. And it will work in this part, ask you to pee more. So when you pee more, you decrease your blood volume. And this AMP's function. And in the salt balance, we mainly focus on sodium. And let's look a little bit of potassium. Potassium balance is regulated by aldosterone as well, because we talk about molecular mechanism of aldosterone. It uses sodium-potassium pump, and that's why aldosterone also regulates potassium. And you still want the potassium level to be normal. When you have too low potassium, you're going to have muscle weakness, because your muscle is hyperpolarized and it's difficult to generate action potential. And you know this pretty well, because when you have muscle weakness, your friend will tell you, oh, eat banana because they have potassium. But your potassium level should not be too high as well, because when you have too high potassium, you will have small or even zero action potential. And that's because potassium is supposed to flow out of the cell. Potassium is supposed to be high inside and low outside. So when you have a lot of potassium in your ECF, it will decrease the concentration gradient, then potassium won't flow out. So potassium level need to be maintained as well. And it's closely tied to the sodium basic balance, so we will talk more about this part when we go to the third part of this chapter, the acid basic balance. And behaviorally, your drinking water is the only way to lose water, so you could not replace that part with conserving water. You really have to drink water. And the salt, the same. You eat salt, it's the only way to keep your sodium content in your body. And this slide shows you, ideally, your body volume, your osmolarity need to be normal. So you eat salt, you will increase the osmolarity, no change in volume. And if you drink a lot of water, you will decrease your osmolarity, also increase your volume. So you want to maintain a normal situation. And let's look at the severe dehydration situation. This is you got lost in the desert for 3 days, you cannot find water, and your body will have no pee, almost no pee. So let's see what happens when you are in a severe dehydration situation. A little bit different. And let's look at similarity part. Similar to dehydration situation, you're dehydrated, your osmolarity increase will trigger the hypothalamus release vasopressin, and also you feel very thirsty, you can looking for water. This part is the same. Now let's look at this part. This part is still the same. This part is low blood volume, low blood pressure will ask your CVCC and will increase your sympathetic output, decrease your parasympathetic. So this part is the same. The difference part is this one. So your low blood volume, low blood pressure will trigger the RAS system. And from the renin, it will trigger the ANG2. From the ANG2, will trigger aldosterone. So ANG2 trigger aldosterone release, but aldosterone is sodium reabsorption. So this time you actually don't want to have sodium come back because your body have too much osmolarity. You want to decrease the sodium. And you could not prevent this pathway from happening in the beginning part because the trigger is low blood volume and low blood pressure. So you have to use the inhibitory pathway. High osmolarity will go to the adrenal cortex, will actually inhibit aldosterone release because you don't want to have too much sodium back. So that's the difference part. High osmolarity will actually inhibit aldosterone release. So that's the severe dehydration. This part is different from mild dehydration. Okay, let's take a break.